Thanks, Harry. Good morning to all of you. It's really a privilege to be here at this distinguished gathering, and perhaps especially to engage in some discussion with all of you, the future leaders of clinical research, upon which we depend very seriously for the opportunities that lie in front of us, which have never been more exciting than they are right now. We are, of course, facing certain challenges, and I'm sure we'll talk about that as well, particularly when it comes to resources. But I think scientifically and medically, there's never been a better time to get engaged in clinical research. And I'll try to convey some of that excitement in my opening remarks. Again, it's really wonderful to be able to share this panel with my colleagues from FDA and CMS. We're working quite closely on a number of projects together that will probably come up in the course of the discussion. So, I thought I would focus particularly on translational research, but I thought I would also try to briefly at least touch upon a few other areas of major current focus at NIH that are driven by scientific opportunity. Our mission statement at NIH is a dual one: science in pursuit of fundamental knowledge about the nature and behavior of living systems. That's the basic science part of our agenda, and the application of that knowledge to extend healthy life and reduce the burdens of illness and disability. If you look at how our funds are distributed, about 52% is basic research, and that percentage has stayed rather constant over the course of the last 20 years, and I don't expect it's going to change drastically going forward. About 35% in applied clinical research, and you can see from the pie chart the other pieces as well. In putting together our proposal that the President included in the President's budget for FY12, four themes were identified as exceptionally opportunistic for NIH research. The first of those, accelerating discovery through technology, builds upon the fact that we are, at the present time, able to invest in several new technologies that give us the chance to answer questions we couldn't really have addressed before. And of course, there are many things on that list, including imaging approaches, nanotechnology, computational strategies. But I just want to mention one which is near and dear to my heart and which is certainly empowering vast amounts of research, which is the remarkable drop in DNA sequencing costs, which both allows the sequencing of a complete genome now for $8,000 or thereabouts, but also puts into people's hands the ability to do experiments that replace hybridization with DNA sequence data because of the very high throughput of next-generation sequencing machines. And as you can see from this graph, the remarkable drop in cost outstripping Moore's law quite substantially with the way in which costs have come down, even at the same time maintaining very high quality. This has put into our hands the chances to address clinical questions that might previously have been pretty difficult. I'll just give you one example. The Undiagnosed Diseases Program at the NIH Clinical Center brings individuals in who have otherwise not been able to be given a diagnosis after much medical investigation. The two sisters you see here were identified as having progressive debilitating joint pain and this very strange and dramatic calcium buildup in the arteries of their hands and feet, but not the coronary arteries. After some investigation that included complete sequencing of their genomes, it turns out that they have a mutation in a gene that's not previously been described as playing a role in disease, namely the gene NT5E. And that gene encodes the protein CD73 that converts AMP to adenosine. So this single family, not only providing a wonderful detective story for medical investigation, also shedding light on a pathway not previously appreciated that probably has considerable consequences for our understanding of vascular biology. None of this would have been possible, I think, without the advances in DNA analysis that are now available to lots of centers. And I think we're going to see a proliferation in a wonderful way of discovery of new causes of rare diseases by that kind of availability. But of course, we not only want to discover what are the fundamental causes of disease, we want to try to apply that. And of course, we all recognize that's called translation, and we all recognize it's hard, and it's failure prone, and it's prolonged oftentimes, occupying many years. And that would be the need to try to build this bridge across from fundamental knowledge to its application. NIH has been deeply engaged in that for a long period of time, although perhaps less well recognized that NIH has actually been deeply engaged in developing actual therapeutics. We did an inventory in 2010 about 550 projects identified, as you can see here, divided between drugs, devices, vaccines, and biologics, and amounting to several billion dollars of research investment, particularly heavily in cancer and infectious disease. And this was recently surveyed in this paper in the New England Journal from February, pointing out that, in fact, the public sector, funded in many instances, most instances, by NIH, has played a major role in the discovery of drugs and vaccines, including some pretty famous ones, as you see here. So it's not as if NIH is just getting into the translational space anew, but it does seem as if there might be some opportunities here for new approaches. This audience is probably quite familiar with the steps that you have to travel to go from a basic discovery of the molecular cause of a disease, which could be thought of as a target for therapeutics. If you're interested then in converting that into an FDA-approved small molecule approach, the steps you need to follow include assay development, high-throughput screening, medicinal chemistry in order to optimize your initial hits. And those capabilities are provided for many academic investigators now by a program in the Common Fund called the Molecular Libraries Initiative that has produced almost 150 promising compounds, some of which are basically tool compounds for research, but about half of which are promising in terms of taking them to the next step of preclinical analysis, which of course is PD and PK, and toxicology to assess whether this is something you might be able to put into patients. And we do have programs at NIH now just getting underway called TREND and another one called RAID that provide those kinds of resources for investigators who have a promising compound they want to take to the next step, ultimately to an FDA IND application. If that goes well, then of course, phase 1, 2, and 3 trials, FDA review, and on to the clinic. And of course, there's also much opportunity for post-marketing research. In that regard, the NIH Clinical Center, with its 240 research beds, is very engaged in phase 1 and 2 trials. And most importantly, in terms of capability, the CTSAs, the 55 centers across the country, represented, I'm sure, by many of you in this room, provide also that capability, both for phase 1 and 2 trials of new molecular entities and, of course, for other downstream research involving comparative effectiveness and community outreach. Now, on top of that, we've been working hard together with the FDA, and Peggy and I have joined to try to do this in a particularly novel and energetic way to be sure that we're making the most of the partnerships between our agencies. We have collectively pooled some funds together and started a regulatory science initiative, and I'm sure Peggy will tell you more about the enthusiasm that she has carried forward for regulatory science as a way of informing FDA in their challenge to do review at a time where scientific strategies are changing rapidly. And this initiative is providing some pretty exciting science to inform that process. And Peggy and I have joined together to form a leadership council, which has as its goal, as you can see here, advancing translational science. This council is populated by leading institute directors at NIH and by center directors at FDA. Has broken down into 6 working groups that are reviewing various opportunities for collaboration. As you can see, quite a number of things here that we could tackle. So those FDA partnerships, I think, are another important part of this. Now what I want to tell you about, though, is the opportunity that we see to bring together these various components, most of which are already in place, in a new way, to create a new center, the National Center for Advancing Translational Sciences, or NCATS, which is scheduled to stand up on October 1st. The goal, the mission of this NCATS is to advance the discipline of translational science and catalyze the development and testing of novel diagnostics and therapeutics across a wide range of human diseases and conditions. Importantly, this will not become the sole place where translation is supported at NIH. That will continue to be done in a larger scale by the institutes that are already very invested in this kind of work. And I mentioned cancer and infectious disease, but it extends to virtually all of the 27 institutes and centers. But what NCATS aims to do is to provide a hub for this sort of activity, and particularly to do something that hasn't been so much possible until now, and that is to focus on the therapeutic development pipeline itself as a scientific problem. Are there more efficient ways to do virtual drug design? Are there more efficient ways to do toxicology? Why do we depend upon animal testing, which we all know has its limitations and is slow and expensive, when there might be better ways to assess toxicity before giving a compound first in human? So the challenges, then, that NCATS aims to try to address are this deluge of new discoveries of potential targets for rare diseases, for common diseases, for neglected diseases, providing a great moment of opportunity in terms of doing the translational steps, but obviously a bit daunting to try to figure out how to sift through those 4,000 diseases that have had their molecular basis discovered in the last few years, many of which have no therapy available. How do we move that along? Unmet therapeutic needs crying for attention. But again, I think the main focus of NCATS is to try to figure out how can we do that more efficiently, not in a series of one-off projects, but to view drug development as a scientific problem, ripe for experimentation and process engineering. NCATS will not duplicate other translational research activities supported by NIH. It will not compete with the private sector, but rather complement the private sector, aiming to de-risk projects to make them more attractive for commercial uptake when they may initially seem too risky or economically unattractive. And lest anyone be concerned that this is going to result in a major shift of the balance between basic and clinical research, we do not expect that to be the case. I hope you can see the components that are going to go into NCATS are pretty much already there and are already funded, but are going to be reorganized in this new way. Let me continue quickly to touch upon the other two themes that NIH is currently mentioning as particularly high likelihoods for innovative opportunities. And one of those is to enhance the evidence base for healthcare decisions. This is, of course, a critical part of our nation's forward motion in trying to revamp healthcare. NIH has been engaged in comparative effectiveness research for a long time, although we didn't necessarily call it that until more recently. And we have engaged in that in prevention and diagnosis and treatment, behavior change, health systems, special populations. And you can see some of the publications that have come out of those efforts given here. And we were very much involved in the effort as part of the Recovery Act to encourage more in the area of comparative effectiveness research in order to inform healthcare decisions. When the IOM put out their report in the summer of 2009 identifying 100 priority areas, we looked at our inventory and noted that 88 of those had research projects underway, and certainly we filled in the remainder over the course of the last 2 years. So we are a big investor in this effort. Mike Lauer and I have written about that in this article in JAMA last summer. Of course, there's a new entry on the scene here, which is PCORI, the Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute, established by the Affordable Care Act. And PCORI, which has a multi-member board on which I sit, as does Carolyn Clancy, the director of ARC, is aiming to set up an effort which ultimately will rise to $500 million a year in research funding to support the kind of comparative effectiveness research we most need in order to empower patients and providers to make decisions that are going to result in the best possible outcomes. So this is clearly an enterprise that's a major new arrival on the scene in terms of this kind of research. I should say we are having a very good time working with Don Berwick and his senior leadership at CMS and thinking also about how to be sure that what we're learning from comparative effectiveness research gets implemented as quickly as possible. And obviously, CMS is in a critical role to make that happen. And Don may very well say some things about our shared efforts in such things as trying to figure out how to implement the use of helical CT for heavy smokers, which has recently been shown in an NCI study to actually save lives by identifying lung cancer while it's still possible to be cured. We're also talking extensively about how to implement the results of the diabetes prevention program, which we know is highly successful in reducing the incidence of diabetes if you offer the appropriate resources to people who already have impaired glucose tolerance. And there is an opportunity which could greatly improve the outcome for large numbers of people and greatly reduce our healthcare costs, but would have to be applied in a very creative way. So, of course, we can't talk about comparative effectiveness research or this part of our agenda without referring very explicitly to this remarkable network of skills and capabilities represented by the CTSAs. CTSAs at the moment, 55, probably soon to be 60, because there's a new round of competition that's in the process of being reviewed. And as you can see, representing very broadly the U.S. And bringing together clinical researchers in remarkable new ways that I think are still being sorted out in terms of how to make the most of this network. Certainly, one of the things the network provides the capability of is to be a data warehouse, so the IT parts of this are critical. Other parts that are particularly important relate to the capability of doing CER, also of doing phase one and two trials, and if we're successful in seeing more translational efforts producing biologics and small molecules and drugs and devices, then this will be a really important engine for testing those out. But also, this is a wonderful network for encouraging training of clinical researchers. And I suspect in this room, there are probably quite a few people who are, in fact, supported by training programs within the CTSAs. And we're very enthusiastic about seeing how that goes forward. And that brings me to the fourth of the bullets, which in many ways is the most important. We can have all these great scientific ideas and opportunities, but if we don't have a community of researchers to carry them out, then we won't get very far. NIH is critically interested in trying to be sure that even in a time of constrained resources, we are encouraging investigators to enter the field and to see this as a stable career path. And we have done a number of things in terms of creating new programs that encourage those who have not previously been supported by NIH to come and join, and also particularly to encourage innovation. Just mention one of the many programs that have recently been instituted for your attention. I could go through a long list of others. This one has just come about, and I thought I would bring it to this audience's attention. This is a partnership between NIH and the Lasker Foundation, essentially trying to create or recreate the kind of opportunities that were so productive back in the 1960s. When the so-called Yellow Berets came to NIH in large numbers during the time of the Vietnam War as an alternative to being drafted. And if you look around to see the Nobel laureates and other leaders in medicine, you'd be amazed to find out how many of them traveled through NIH at that timetable. It is a remarkable place to get clinical training. So working with the Lasker Foundation, we have put together this plan to support a small number of exceptional early-stage clinical researchers. The idea is it has two phases. The first phase, a five-year and maybe as much as seven-year intramural research program as a tenure-track investigator within one of the institutes and centers, provided with space, research expenses, salary, and support to be able to carry out an independent research program. And then depending on what happens after that, such individuals might be candidates to remain at NIH or to go out and find themselves a wonderful home in one of the national research capable centers, and actually to go with research support for a couple of years in order to make that transition relatively smooth. It is the goal, therefore, not just to benefit the intramural program, but actually to benefit the whole country with this new kind of training opportunity. And I hope some of you in the room who might be good candidates for this will take note, because the competitions will start in the fairly near future for the first round of this NIH Lasker Clinical Research Scholars Program. I can't finish without pointing out that we are facing some significant challenges in terms of resources, and that is why many of the ideas that we're talking about have to be thought through carefully in terms of our priorities. If you look at the purple bars here, this is the actual dollars appropriated to NIH since 1998. You'll see that wonderful doubling that happened between 98 and 2003, but then you'll see that that levels off. The yellow bars are what happens when you factor in inflation, namely the bird pie, the Biomedical Research and Development Price Index. And you can see with that considered, unfortunately, we have been losing ground since 2003. At the moment, we finally, as of a couple weeks ago, do know what our budget is for 2011. And while we did sustain a 1% cut in the NIH budget, it could have been far worse. And in some versions of the FY11 budget, it was far worse. And so much credit due to those who rose to the occasion and carried the message to decision makers about why medical research is such a good investment and why it both improves the future of human health but also stimulates the economy and supports American competitiveness. Those messages are really important to convey right now. The President's budget for 2012 proposes a $750 million increase for NIH, and that is now being discussed on the Hill. If that were to come to pass, that would help a little bit in that it would at least keep us from losing further ground to inflation. But I think you can see here from the yellow line that even if that is successful, we will see ourselves effectively at the purchasing power that we had 10 years ago. That is going to make everything a little harder than you would want it to be. At the same time, we all conduct research in a way that is an essential human activity, a noble activity. I think we can continue to make that case, and as we go through this difficult period, that I think will ultimately serve us well by pointing out that what our government can do by the support of medical research is a genuine good for the present and for the future. So I conclude with a quote, which is my favorite one, from my favorite person to quote, especially to this audience, Sir William Osler, describing what it is that we do as physicians, as clinical researchers, to wrest from nature the secrets that have perplexed philosophers in all ages, to track to their sources the causes of disease, to correlate the vast stores of knowledge that they may be quickly available for the prevention and cure of disease. These are our ambitions. Those words spoken a century ago certainly resonate, I think, with this audience in terms of both our goal and our potential for achieving those goals. And for me, having been as a medical researcher involved in many of these efforts now for almost 30 years, seems to me there's never been a more exciting time than there is right now. So I'm happy to be here with you and to be part of this panel. Thank you very much.